GG, no re.
Foreplay.
We're off to a good start.
Yep. It's all good.
It's GG, no re. Long time no see. That rhymes. Look at me.
What up, B?
We're gonna kill all them.
It's like a big clock tower.
It's GG, no re. A podcast on the internet.
For nerds.
About role-playing games. It's not as good as the previous introduction.
No.
This episode is going to be us not creating characters, but using characters that have already been created, and then hacking them to be evocative of the Pathfinder 2nd Edition that's coming out soon. Except these are 5e characters. There is a blog post on our website, ggnorecast.com, where you can read about how you can take what is known about the Pathfinder 2 playtest and import what's good into 5e and hack it in. We've not tested this yet. I don't know if anyone has, but we shall this very night. Skip this if you don't find that interesting, or just make yourself endure it. It'll build character. First things first, gents. HP. Now,
HP.
Imagine that you want everything to be easy in your life.
So we're playing a baby game.
You're taking some handouts.
Happy birthday, communism.
And Pathfinder is kind of like a 4E, which Pathfinder 2E is taking stuff from 4E and 5E. What you're going to do is you take your class HP. 5E gives you your maximum of your HD, right? So if you're a fighter, you have a D10 HP, you take 10 HP. Plus your con mod, so you guys should already have that.
Mm-hmm.
However, you're also going to take the max, basically, racial HD and add that on top. So I'm just interpreting that to be by size. So if you're a human or just medium size, add 8 points to your max HP at first level. I assume most of you guys are human.
Yep.
Okay, so whatever you have, it's plus 8.
Definitely racist.
That's racist!
And if you're a little boy, like a little hobbit boy, add 6. All right, and later at later levels when you level up, you won't roll. You'll just add your class HD max again. So you're going to have lots of HP.
So no much. Rolling.
That's what it says. It's just like in 4E. You just add your result. Although 4E used the half of your HD rounded up. They didn't call it HD, but that's how they derived those numbers.
Mm.
It's secret. They didn't tell you that. That's the kind of stuff you only get from Genori.
Mm.
It's exclusive content.
You're welcome.
Long rests. They even talk about short and long rests in Pathfinder 2.
Mm.
They restore your con mod times your level in HP, which I like that.
Okay.
Falling damage is 1 point of damage per foot fallen.
1 point of damage per foot?
Yeah, so if you fall 10
per
feet.
Per foot?
Yeah.
Okay, no, that's good.
Yeah, it's good too. I like it. It's simple.
Yeah, it's better than 1d6 per 10 feet.
That's nothing.
Yeah, it's garbage.
Yeah.
Would you start that number at 10 feet?
Well, it depends on how many feet you fall.
So if you fall 5 feet?
5 damage.
If you fall 2 feet?
Is it like
damage.
Fall, or is like if I'm intentionally jumping down 5 feet?
Well, that's the ruling that will have to be made by your dungeon master.
All right.
I'd say you get your first 10 feet free if you're doing it on purpose.
Okay. But
hey.
So if you have more than 50 HP, mm-hmm. I mean, you could easily have more than 50 HP. You could fall 50 feet and not die.
Apparently. There might be some kind of like massive damage rule or something.
Okay. You could easily have 100 HP and fall 100 feet. Well, just saying.
You can do that. I mean, it's even more egregious in 5e.
Is it?
Yeah. Because it's only 1d6 per 10 feet.
Oh, shoot, isn't it? Yeah. It could only be 10d6.
Yep, that's nothing.
Maximum of 60.
Yep.
Nothing.
Stop tapping on the table. We're professionals here. All right.
When's the last time we recorded?
2 weeks ago.
Well.
And it was an amazing recording.
Yeah.
I got nothing.
All right, so proficiency bonus. Subtract 1 from your proficiency.
Oh.
Ouch.
It's just your level. And when you level up, it'll increase.
Oh, never mind.
And when you do something untrained that needs to be trained, you instead subtract 1 from whatever you would roll. So it's effectively plus 2, because untrained people subtract 1 from the roll and you add 1. So that's a difference of 2 between trained and untrained. You see? Ripping off Watsy again.
Hello! I like money!
But I kind of like the elegance of just increasing it by 1 each time. That's kind of what 4E did, except they did it worse, because it was half every half, wait, 2 levels you increase by 1. And this is easier to keep track of. Although, of course, your numbers are going to inflate by a lot.
I'm gonna pump those numbers up. Those are rookie numbers in this racket.
Crits. In addition to the... So, Pathfinder previously was doing a thing where you had to confirm criticals. Like, you get a 20, doesn't necessarily mean you critted. You have to check and see if you critted, like in 3E. However, now they're doing the 5E thing where you roll 20, bam, you got the crit. However, there's an additional rule that if you exceed the AC or DC by 10, you also crit, even if you didn't roll that 20.
Wow.
So if you're up against a bunch of scrubs, you're going to be wrecking them. I assume your AC also increases every level because you're proficient in your armor. Checks for pretty much every ability or skill, you have a defensive version of it that translates to a DC 10 plus the ability training and bonus. So it's just like 5e, it's like your passive perception is 10 plus your wisdom score. And this is 10 plus your wisdom score plus your level if you're trained in whatever. So just assume that for anything you can do, you have a defensive version of it that you don't roll for, you just attend on. Initiative is, by default, it's just a perception roll. But if you're doing something else when combat happens, you roll that skill. So if you're tracking, you roll survival, which they have a survival skill now. So you may have to roll something else for initiative, but it's not that big a deal. Encumbrance uses a slot-based system like Starfinder, which is their sci-fi pathfinder. So basically, you have slots, so you're going to need to write this down. This is actually better than 5e's version. It's not as good as mine, but I mean, what is? You can carry significant items. That's something that's reasonably heavy. Up to half your strength score before becoming encumbered. So if your strength is 18, you've got 9 slots, 9 significant items that you can carry before incurring any kind of penalty. After that, and up to your full strength, you're encumbered. And after your full strength, like if you have 18 strength, your 19th item would cause you to be overburdened, which means you can basically just stumble around. That's the thing that a lot of OSR people have come up with, just slots based on your strength score. And if you have small items that don't count as significant, just tally them up, and for every tenth small item you have, that counts as one significant item.
So the backpack counts as a significant item, or is there, like, items in the backpack could count as significant items?
I would just treat containers as nothing. They're just ways to hold stuff.
I mean, like, so okay, so the container, you don't say the backpack and everything in it counts as one significant item.
It's just whatever is it. Generally, containers, I'm not going to count as an item that's significant.
What I'm saying is, like, everything in the backpack.
The purpose of calculating encumbrance, don't worry about containers and what's in where.
Okay.
Yep. That's for the purpose of figuring out if you lost something. Your items are going to have hardness and can take dents, which means they can be destroyed. Don't worry about that. We'll get to that. If you have a shield, though, let me know. Does anyone have a shield?
Yes.
No.
Okay. Is it iron? I'll assume it's iron. It's going to have hardness 9.
And, really?
Yep. And
on a scale of?
It's like a hit point value. Mm. If it takes damage over that, it will take a dent. When it takes so many dents, it's destroyed.
Mm, okay.
And there are special things you can do to
advanced.
I'm glad they made this so fiddly.
It's very fiddly, but I kind of like.
Do all the other items have stats?
No, I don't think so. Oh. This is also another OSR thing. The thing about dents in your shield and all this kind of stuff. If you're on the G+, you will have seen all this before.
Pathfinder hears you. It gives you what you need.
Yeah, there's item quality here. So I'm going to assume that your quality for your shield is just normal. So I'm going to say it can take one dent, and then its next one, it's destroyed. And a poor quality shield, if it takes anything, it's gone. Okay. So quality, mundane gear has tiers of quality that equate to plus ones, plus three, or minus one. So that's like the equivalent of Masterwork Armor from 3E. So you can go up to plus three on an item without it even being magical, which means you can also have a really terrible ones like minus three, right? Normal is plus zero. And it affects attack rolls for weapons, so not damage rolls, and AC for armor. Combat has some big changes. There's no, and this is what we're going to use, there's no bonus move. Okay, forget all that. Instead, things just cost action. You have 3 actions per turn. You can attack 3 times in a turn if you want. However, there are special exceptions, like each additional attack incurs a bigger penalty, that kind of thing. But you can move 3 times if you want. If you want to not provoke off attacks, that's just 1 action, and you move 5 feet. And then you can take another action to move your normal speed. If something costs a bonus action on your character sheet, just assume that's 1 action.
Okay.
And then most of your other actions are going to be 1 action. Mm-hmm. But there are things like readying a shield. That is an action. And you can do special stuff with it, which we'll talk about later.
So it completely changes all our characters.
No, not really. I think it makes understanding movement easier, because teaching new players what disengage does is really hard in 5e.
It's really confusing
for
new players.
It just applies a condition to you, which is weird to think about since it's a kind of movement-related action. Mm-hmm. But and here, it's easy. You just take an action to move. Attacking, so your second attack gets you a minus 5 penalty or disadvantage. Your third attack gets you a minus 10 or a double disadvantage, however you want to do it. And touch attacks were a thing. That's your no armor bonus to AC, although your level and dexterity would still apply. That was in 3E. They dropped it in 4 and 5.
If you make a touch attack, they don't get the bonus, the AC bonus?
Yes. It's like a touch attack is something that it doesn't armor's not going to help you against it.
Right. Right. Okay.
It's just your
like dexterity. Shocking grass.
Yep.
Yeah. We'll see. So that's
that
really
makes
nice.
Sense. Like,
yeah.
It's like, don't matter if I just need to touch you. It doesn't matter what I'm touching on you. It's that I'm touching you. Yeah.
So spell casting's a little different, and it might be to your preference. But do we have any spellcasters?
Nah.
You are?
Mm-hmm.
Oh. Okay. So
but he's a warlock.
Any particular leveled spell, so any spell that has a level, mm-hmm. it's not a cantrip, can't itself be cast more than once per turn.
Okay.
But nothing prevents you from casting more than one spell per turn.
What?
As long as it's different spells.
You can cast three spells in a turn.
So, I mean, that sounds more, that sounds stronger than
yes.
than fighty.
It is.
Yeah.
However, so you can cast three cantrips per turn.
Yep.
Okay.
Oh. However, each, theoretically, but the action you take when you cast a spell is per component. So if there's a verbal component and a somatic component, each one of those eats up a turn, an action. So a spell that has a verbal component, and that's it, just costs one action.
Okay, so imagine if that you verbal take and somatic, it would be two components.
Two actions, yeah.
So I could potentially min-max it if I was looking to do that
yes.
on my spells. Okay, well, I got this cantrip was verbal, and this cantrip was somatic only, and I could maximize my actions.
So, and you can also do something like, let's say you have one...
Totally not going to do that. That's really advanced.
Let's say you have one action left this turn,
yeah.
and your spell has two components. You could cast one of its components at the end of your turn, and then the other one at the start of your next turn.
Oh, that's cool.
And then, boom, it's off in one action in your turn.
Yeah, that's really cool.
Mm. Is it?
I think I kind of like it, honestly.
It is. It makes combat feel more fluid in a sense, because it's like, it's not like Final Fantasy. It's like, your turn. Okay, now it's my turn. Okay, your turn. And now it's my turn. It feels like it's moving more.
Okay, so here's another thing. Mm. So clerics, I mean, doesn't really matter, I don't think, here, but they have like a channel divinity, a channel energy, 5 times a day at first level. But there's cool stuff they can do, like however many actions you use on a single thing determines its effects. So like one action heals self, two actions heals at range, 3 actions heals in a burst or damages undead.
Oh, that's neat.
That's kind of cool. So if you're in place, you can just...
So what you're saying is you want to play Pathfinder 2.0.
I'm just saying I like that idea. It's kind of it's kind of nice.
Mm-hmm.
What was that for?
As a cleric's channel divinity. Okay. So movement.
I feel like I should be a cleric and I would get use that.
Do it.
Almost all my stuff is verbal and somatic. So every spell I have...
A normal spell is 2 actions.
But you can do 3 verbals. Like verbal, right?
Yeah, but...
If you have something that's just verbal, though.
Okay.
But if it has verbal and somatic, it has to be 2 actions.
Yep.
Which I'm guessing
most things are...
They probably thought that through in designing their spells and Pathfinder.
Yeah,
I mean,
they just took over most of the D&D spells, so it's all pretty much the same.
Yeah.
Okay, so movement, like I said, you can move 3 times if you want. Jumping or climbing onto something is a separate action. And then moving without provoking costs... And then every...
Dodge.
This uses old-school movement,
shift.
Where every other diagonal move costs an extra 5 feet.
Huh. Oh, I'm glad they brought that back.
Interesting.
Jim says sarcastically.
Oh.
Okay, so they took D&D 5's reaction system, so you only get one reaction per round, right?
Yeah.
So it's right. Yeah, that's right. But not everybody has the attack of opportunity reaction. Fighters start with it, but other people have different ones.
Yeah, bro.
Opponents for me, I'm a warlock.
Yeah. So like rogues have a thing where they can grant themselves an AC bonus against an attack that's coming into them once per round. Conditions, that doesn't matter for us right now. Although prone is -2 to attacks, flanked to flat footed is -2, yada, yada, yada. Those are the big ones. We'll get into them as we need to. But as you can see, the biggest things are proficiency, the action economy, and HP.
So if AC doesn't scale with level, it does make armor sort of irrelevant. I mean, for sure.
Unless it assumes that you're going to be finding increasingly magical armor, which I don't know if it will. For our purposes here, I'm just going to have it scale per level, just like 4E did.
Yeah.
And we'll just do it that way. Cause
I wonder if that's how they're going to do it. 5E does do a similar thing. Armor doesn't really change that much. It hardly changes at all.
But also your bonuses hardly change. You get up to +6 on proficiency.
Exactly.
And that's it.
But maybe that'll be interesting too, because then you don't have giant sacks of HP that aren't hitting each other. I mean, you have giant sacks of HP that are doing giant damage to each other. So maybe that'll be kind of fun too.
We'll see.
I don't know. I still want playtest material to actually play this without buying their stuff, to be honest.
Oh, my original post had an error in it. The PDFs are going to be free.
Okay.
Although you can buy hard copies of the playtest material.
Did you see when it's going to be released?
I think it's fall.
I do really like the action economy, though. I think that's a fun idea. And it's I love the simplicity and symmetry. Just saying, oh, we get three things you can do. And
also, the reason I like the spellcasting thing is because it makes you remember what components you have.
Yeah, which usually doesn't matter.
You never think about that. Mm-mm. Unless it... No, you never do.
It's super rare.
So this one, you probably will. Although, I think with how many costs two actions, you might not end up paying attention to it after a while. But in principle, I like the idea. All right, well, GG No Re, we're going to see how this works out. And actual play. I'm going to say GG Now Re one more time. Amen.